Join the Toronto Holocaust Museum and its partners for a community-wide Yom HaShoah commemoration on Sunday, May 5th. A moving evening of film, candlelighting, music, and a tribute to survivors we've recently lost. Keynote speaker Yoni Berus from Yad Vashem will reflect on Holocaust remembrance post-October 7th. The program is at Beth Emeth Synagogue at 7 p.m. Register at torontoholocaustmuseum.org.
Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt land.
This is Bonjour Chai, the third annual Great Canadian Seder edition. I'm Avi Feingold, and I'm here with Phoebe Maltzbovi. We are your Frozen Chosen. On today's show, we will continue our tradition of hearing from Canadians across the country and beyond about their Seder traditions and what they find meaningful about Passover. Stay tuned.
So hard they could not stand.
Let my people go.
Passover, the celebration of freedom, the founding of the Jewish people as a nation. And while there are many who rightfully say that this year is a particularly difficult year to celebrate, we should nevertheless recognize this holiday and rejoice in the freedoms that we have. We hold a space for those who are not free this year, and we remember that in every year since we left Egypt, there has been someone who isn't free. There is something that holds us back as a nation from a complete freedom. Passover is a time to inhabit that space, enjoy it, and figure out what to do with that freedom. There's a line you hear a lot in therapy about how hurt people hurt people. I'd like to suggest that free people free people. This Passover, as we contemplate our freedom, let's think about who we can free and what we can free them from. Let's kick things off with some teachers and students from the Gray Academy Kindergarten in Winnipeg. Throughout our Seder, you'll be hearing from them and what they believe freedom is.
What's freedom, Lois?
It means to go to Palm Springs and get candy whenever I want and not asking my parents.
And you don't have to ask anyone?
Yeah.
Hi, this is Silvina.
And this is Candice.
We teach kindergarten at Gray Academy in Winnipeg.
We wanted to share with you some of the responses to the question, what does freedom mean to you? We asked our kindergarten students when we were learning about Pesach what they thought about freedom. And here's some of their responses.
Hashem is a gift because Hashem gave us freedom. Hashem is our guide and we should help others in need and fight for what is right.
Mo is my grandpa's name. His name reminds me of Moshe, helping us to be free.
People can tell other people what to do.
Freedom means sharing when I play with my friends.
Freedom means being able to bring kosher wine and matzah to your seder. You are free when others are free.
I feel free when I'm playing.
Freedom feels good.
Freedom feels happy.
Chag Pesach Sameach, Am Yisrael Chai.
So the Lord said,
go down,
Moses,
Moses,
way,
way down,
down in Egypt land. Tell old Pharaohs to let my people go.
Let my people go.
Well, so Avi, I have four questions for you. Just kidding. I have some questions for you about the Seder of this year.
That's what the Seders are about.
Yes,
it's about asking questions.
Yes. Specifically, it seems like we're perhaps at a moment a bit in the Jewish world, similar to where things were in the United States after Donald Trump's presidential election, when there were all these think pieces and just sort of everyday chit-chat about what's going to happen once you have to go to family Thanksgiving and you're going to have to confront your, sometimes it was the racist uncle, sometimes it was the Republican uncle, sometimes these were the same uncle. But anyway, there were all these discussions about what's going to happen at family meals. And I'm wondering whether these are conversations happening in the Jewish community at the moment regarding the Seder.
Actually, yeah. And I've noticed multiple articles come out recently about how to talk to relatives who might have very, very different opinions than you might about what's going on in the world. And you have to sit at the Seder with them. And Israel stuff is inevitably going to come up. And I have seen in some various rabbinic listservs, which means that I'm not going to talk more about details, but I have seen some cases where people are very concerned about this, where they have kids that are very, very different politically, and they have to balance two sets of children or two sets of grandchildren, where a lot of this is going to happen and they don't know what to do. So they go to their rabbi for advice. But I also suspect that it's one of those situations. You know, I remember during the pandemic, at the very, very early stages of the pandemic, Passover was coming up, and you had all of these people posting on Facebook, if you're going to be alone because of all of the social distancing and we're only a month into this, we don't know what we're doing, please reach out to me, please call me, even if it's Shabbat, even if it's a holiday. And it was kind of overprotective just to be sure. But I think that people sometimes like to go the extra mile just to make sure that everybody's going to be okay. And I think that it's a little bit of that and a little bit of the, you know, people are actually worried about it. But anyways, yeah, it's hard, but I think it's harder because we're in a more polarized society. And I don't think we've been as polarized as we have been. And I think that when you had, you know, your crazy Republican uncle or your crazy Democrat progressive cousin, the yelling was at least theoretical. It was around, but you could at least get along and finally sit at the meal and actually enjoy yourselves. But it's gotten worse, and people don't even want to be around people that they don't agree with. But what more place to be able to be argumentative and to discuss in a way that you can be real about it than at the Seder, because it's about asking questions and it's about being able to pointedly go and show, no, I'm right, no, I'm right, no, I'm right. That's what the Seder was about, asking and seeing if you're right or seeing if you're wrong. The symposium style is there for a reason. And I don't think we should be afraid of dialogue and heated dialogue, even at the Seder.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I've been thinking about this in terms of the implosion at Guernica, everybody's favorite magazine that nobody had heard of prior to all of its drama. I'm thinking about the way there seems to be a split, not so much even just over what Israel should do or anything like that, but over the value of there being people who disagree in the same space hashing it out. So there's, on the one hand, political rifts, you know, but then there's just this rift of like, should people just be siloed and in their safe spaces with everybody who agrees with them? Or is there a positive value of these spaces, especially in real life spaces, but also, you know, magazines and so forth, where people disagree?
Well, if there's one thing that we've learned, and I've mentioned this many times, that the Talmud and the rabbinic imagination is specifically built for this type of era and this type of discussion, to be able to not only allow for dissent, but to preserve wrong opinions as a way of saying, this might be wrong now, but at least we want this opinion to be there because we could learn from it. And it might be something of value to learn from it in the future. And we are all collecting all the opinions because we don't want the debate to be stifled. And we want people to see that this is how we actually get at a deeper truth. And the Haggadah is actually a product of the rabbinic imagination. It was written in Mishnaic times, the vast majority of it, and it holds very, very contradictory ideas. And it's not just, you know, the things like, well, there were 50 miracles or there were 200 miracles that happened or 250. It's not just things like that. It's many different ways of viewing what actually the Exodus was or what the purpose of it was. And a lot of the text and a lot of the dialogue is there to get us to show that there's no universal way of thinking about all of the different pieces. It's not one way mm-hmm. to be. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. that's something that we can take with us even in 2024 to be able to say, yes, I would like to debate you, but I don't think that I am writer or you are writer. This is a way of us getting at a deeper, more shared reality.
I guess what I'm wondering, though, is, I agree with all of that. However, I don't think that it's very popular these days. And I think you get a lot of people who have a kind of boycott type approach to views different from their own.
I'm thinking about it, for example, in 2024, walking into it, right? Because the Seder is the Haggadah, it's a text, but it's also a living every year sort of tradition where we do discuss, where we do have these things. there are two approaches that one could take into walking into a Seder that address exactly that point. And one is to say, let's put the things aside that are create our differences, and you know, let's just talk about our shared history and talk about the things that we do have in common and the things that we can agree on, and actually have a great discussion and remind ourselves that we are friendly and collegial about these things. And we'll put those things off to the side for another time. We're not ignoring them, but we're just putting them off to the side to remind us that we actually have those things. And then the other approach is to say, no, we actually are going to talk about the tough things. The hard things are, you know, what sometimes divide us, but they also bring us together in our ability to talk about them. And this is my one tip that I do always, you know, think about when, you know, we get to how do you talk about hard questions? And that's with people that have very, very different opinions. And I think that this is actually something that does come from the rabbinic imagination. Again, it's not just that. I'm sure there are many psychologists and many group therapy leaders or any sort of dynamic, you know, discussions. This is a point that comes up, is find the one space that you are willing to recognize the other person's truth first, to sort of say, you know, you might think that we are so far apart on all of these different topics, but this is actually something that you might not realize about me, but I agree with you on this. And coming to them with that, right, admitting and recognizing the truth that the other person has right away is a door that opens up. And the rabbis do this all the time, where they say, you know, I admit that this part that you're saying is right, but I still disagree with you on that part. And that allows for a dialogue to say that, you see, I don't think that you're totally wrong. I think that there's things that you're saying that are true. Why don't you look for the things that are true in my places also,
so
in my things.
That's amazing. And so it's making me think a little bit about something that would happen at, like, where there was this ritual when I was in grad school and you were critiquing another person's work. And it was like you had to sandwich your critique in, like, you know, all of that.
That's like HR speak, right?
It is. Yeah, but yeah. I mean, before I even knew that it was, I remember it was very obvious that that was what was happening, where you had to say, like, your, you know, this outline you did for your, you know, fourth chapter of your dissertation is really, really, the font you chose is spectacular. I don't know what the chapter is supposed to say, but it also, the paper you printed it on is just like exquisite. But anyway, so the other thing though that I was thinking about, with just like, if we step aside from the kind of abstract idea of like reaching common ground with another person's views or whatever, the Seder is also often, you know, a family gathering. And this came up a lot with the whole sort of Republican uncle discourse, but like there is a value in maintaining relationships with people and not falling out with them over politics. You know, like there's enough Burgess out there for like hyper specific reasons that like maybe you don't want to fall out with the only family you have over politics. And I feel like that's another aspect where the Seder is different from Guernica magazine. Because if people who live all around the world and are volunteer staff at a literary magazine fall out with one another, so be it. But like, if it's your family, it's a little different.
Yeah. You know, I've been with families at the highest of times, and I've been with families at the lowest of times. And sometimes you'd be surprised which ones those are, because I'm not going to say that the weddings are always the highest and the funerals are always the lowest. But families that are really close together and are really share something, they get together at a funeral and they, you know, are talking to me and they're so comfortable. They're great. They clearly must have had some disagreements about some stuff, but they get together and they know that they have this shared history, this shared sense of, you know, looking at the world in a certain way, even if the end result might be different. And there's joy in this room, even at a moment of sadness, and the opposite happens. And that's the building blocks of that is the Seder and mm-hmm. is the other moments. It could be your Thanksgiving if you're secular, you know, or you're not Jewish or whatever it is, but the Seder and Rosh Hashanah dinner and all these things, those are the blocks that make a great family or not a great family. And it's not just everybody gathering over the shared love of Bubby's brisket. It could be the shared winking that we say that we love Bubby's brisket, but we know that Bubby's cooking is horrible. Right. And that's another shared thing that you have, and you're able to just talk and looking for those spaces at the Seder.
Well, Bubby's probably sick of cooking the brisket, would be my guess. But I had just one other thought about this before we wrap this segment up, which was just, I think what could be useful about any sort of in-person interaction, particularly a Seder at this time, is that I get the sense that a lot of people kind of align themselves with teams on this, but might actually not just have like commonalities in their views, but may actually think the same thing. Like one person who says they're pro-Israel and another who says they're for a ceasefire. It's very possible that if you were to lay out what they actually want to see happen in the world, it would be identical. And I would not be at all surprised if at some seders, perhaps, people would start chatting. And if they were to actually talk about what they think as versus which stickers they think should go where, they might realize that they all want peace and they all want it achieved in similar ways. You know what I mean? So I think that maybe this might be like any sort of in-person interactions with close family and friends would be a way to get there. Possibly.
Absolutely. I think that there's, you know, you have Avi's tip for the Seder and that's Phoebe's tip for the Seder. So, you know, have ways to go forward with your dialogues and hopefully let us know. Let us know what your dialogues were like and whether, you know, there was any real broigus or whether it was just nachas at the Seder this year.
What are you doing?
New drink.
We're closed. Nice people don't drink on Pesach. They go to the synagogue.
And the Lord brought us forth out of Egypt with a mighty hand and outstretched arm, with a great terribleness.
Okay, well, speaking of family dynamics, here's a couple of stories related to family seders. We'll kick things off with author and Globe and Mail columnist Marsha Letterman, and then our very own CEO, Michael Weisdorf.
I imagine this Passover is going to be unlike any other Passover of my adult life, given what's happening right now in the Middle East and with the explosion of anti-Semitism all over the world. And I'm sure that is going to come up as I gather close friends and family at my home in Vancouver for a potluck Seder. The stories of persecution are going to hit a little closer to home this year, I imagine. But my family has been through much worse, and I'd like to read a couple of short Passover stories from my memoir, Kiss the Red Stairs, The Holocaust Once Removed. The story I heard my mother tell most often about her childhood concerned a new pair of shoes, a teary disappointment, and an ominous foreshadowing that I did not clue into until much, much later. Twice a year, my mother took me shopping for a new outfit, once in the fall for the high holidays, and once in the spring for Passover. And every year, on every mall visit, I heard the same story. As a child, my mother received a new pair of shoes. That Passover, she was the proud owner of a brand new pair of Mary Janes. I understood this to be a very big deal. New clothing was not something that happened on a regular basis in my mother's 1930s Poland world. She would no doubt have lived her young life in a wardrobe of hand-me-downs from her older sister. My mother was over the moon about these new shoes. She was wearing them when one of her uncles arrived at her home for the Seder. He complimented the shoes and followed the observation with an expression my mother led me to believe was common in Yiddish. May you wear them until they fall apart. This was devastating to my mother. What sort of uncle would wish upon her the destruction of her beautiful shoes? She burst into tears. What her uncle meant, of course, was, may you live so long and be so healthy that you outlast the shoes. The Polish or Yiddish or his personal version of wear them in good health. It was just an expression. But then... There's another Passover story my mother told me, this one from wartime, from the ghetto, shortly after they were forcibly relocated there. The family managed to have some semblance of a Seder. A key part of this ritual meal comes after everyone has eaten, when one of the children opens the door for Eliyahu, or the ghost of Elijah, as I interpret it as a kid. In the ghetto, my mother went to open the door for this ritual and screamed. There she found a very bony, old-looking relic of a man standing at the door. Was this Eliyahu? The man was alone and starving. He begged for some food. My mother's father beckoned him inside. There was very little on the table that year, but they invited him to join them. I don't know where he went after that night, but I am certain he did not live through the war. There is no way a man like that could have survived what came next. I think of that man every Passover, and so a tiny bit of him remains alive, the man who had the courage and desperation to wait by a stranger's door and beg for something to eat when it was opened by a child for a ghost. I'm going to think about that man this year, and I hope you will too. Here's to peace this year. Have a good Pesach.
Hi, I'm Dahlia Kurtz, and I guess I am most known as a radio talk show host. I was asked to share this story, or a story, of how Pesach affected me as a little girl, and it all revolves around strawberries and chocolate, but I don't think it revolves around those things for the reasons that you would understand. So we grew up very poor. And the reason we grew up very poor is because long before I was born, my father fought a court case. He fought Jew hate in Quebec. And this was longer than 10 years of his life. And he risked everything for it. In fact, the lawyer who represented the defense, whom my father was suing, was Prime Minister-to-be Brian Mulroney. What happened was, the judge said they had all the evidence in the world to prove that this company did not hire my father for that reason. However, there were no rules, there were no laws against choosing not to hire a Jew just for being a Jew. So the judge couldn't do anything. But what this did is it changed the Quebec Civil Code. And they added in a clause that would not allow companies to discriminate against anyone, whether you're Jewish, whether you're Black, any race, color, creed, religion. This went on to be a catalyst to change our Charter of Rights and Freedoms. So my father was instrumental in adding protections to Canada's Charter of Rights and Freedoms. This was exceptional because it changed the opportunity for millions and millions of people to get a job. But my father couldn't. He was blacklisted. Because my father was blacklisted, he couldn't get work. Not only that, even after I was born, this is years after a decade-long case. And so times were really hard. At 4 years old, I would hide food under my bed because I didn't know if the next day that we would have food to eat, and I wanted to make sure to be able to provide food for my family. But there was always one time of year when we got such special treats, and that was on Pesach. And I always looked forward to it because we got these magnificent strawberries, which at that point I hadn't seen them in maybe a year. And I knew that they were expensive and they were hard for my parents to buy. And they also bought these little log chocolates that I loved so much. And these little elat chocolates that were filled with like a strawberry cream inside. And then there was the chocolate gelt. And these were absolute treasures, especially to someone who would hide food under her bed because I didn't know if I would get them the next day. And then I got these gems. And every year when you would say next year in Jerusalem, to us, to me, Jerusalem was so much more. It was about getting into the light. And I had the hope. The strawberries and the chocolate were my hope that that was to come. And here we are now. And whenever I eat strawberries, I always think of that. And I eat them far more often than one time a year right now. Chocolate, I wish I could eat more often. But as an adult, I understand that you shouldn't. And that is my story of Pesach. אין לי לב לכל החומר שהמרקע מגיש ושלטון העם שוב יורד אל הכביש ואני מתבזה אבל עברנו את פרעה נעבור גם את זה
This This is Michael Weisdorf, the new CEO of the Canadian Jewish News. For me, Pesach, as with many of the Jewish holidays, is about family and tradition. It's taking the highlights of your childhood that you may have experienced around your family Seder or Shabbat dinner or weekly gathering that holds a special place in your heart that you're compelled to bring forward and introduce for your children to experience. My memories of the Pesach Seder growing up run the gamut of spending time with my great-grandparents to reading Manishtanah for quite some time, even though I was the oldest grandchild, to everyone taking turns with reading the Pesach story and how proud my Bobby Stella and Zadie Mack were when I would read my portion of the story in Hebrew. I remember stealing and hiding the Afikoman and negotiating the steep price of, and I know this is going to date myself, a $2 bill for myself and all my cousins for its return. I remember the time when I was 6 years old at my grandparents' house. I jumped at the chance to open the door for Eliyahu. And to my surprise, when I opened the door, a man was standing on the front porch staring back at me. A Jehovah's Witness approached the door precisely as Eliyahu was set to join us at the Seder table. It became a running joke for years to come to ensure we looked out the window first to ensure no one was accompanying Eliyahu to future Seders. A more recent Seder memory is the Pesach where my wife and I learned we were expecting our first child the morning of the first Seder. To avoid suspicion from prying eyes, I would drink from my glass of wine, covertly switch cups with my wife, and then drink from her glass. I definitely had more than the traditional 4 cups of wine that night. Whether it's the traditions you grow up with or traditions you grow to appreciate later in life when attending Seders with others, it's how you weave these traditions together to create your own traditions that your children and your children's children will experience that are most meaningful. Knowing that someday these traditions will also carry forward to future generations, bring a smile to my face each year as we sit around the Seder table retelling the story of Pesach. Chag Sameach, everyone.
In the Passover story, can you tell me something maybe about baby Moses? What happens?
Moshe's mother had to keep baby Moses a secret because if she didn't, he would become a slave. So she put him in the water.
Amazing. I'm going to get you to stop there. That's the perfect start of the story. Ethan, what did Moshe do in the story? Do you remember?
He spoke to God.
He did. And what did Hashem help open? Moshe did something with Hashem's
the sea.
Help. Yeah. And then once the sea was open, who could walk across?
Moses spoke to water and the children on the Passover. Our brother Moses spoke to water and the seas give away.
Sometimes we're blessed with traditions that are handed down from generations, and sometimes we have to or get to create our own. Let's hear from Zach Paikin in Geneva, Switzerland, photographer Naomi Harris, all of whom find themselves in this situation.
You left that sinful army. Mother, ain't you glad that the seas gave away? I'm so glad that the seas gave away. What?
So I'm Zach Paikin, and I am a Canadian born and raised in Toronto, currently living in Geneva, working at a think tank here called the Geneva Center for Security Policy. You know, I had lots of cool sedarim growing up. One of the most powerful memories that I have is how articulate my bubby, Alei Shalom, was in our competition, which was occasionally held, to recite Echad Miodea, who knows one in English. And basically, you had to be able to recite the entirety of a paragraph. Of course, these paragraphs got longer and longer as you went along, and you had to recite the whole paragraph in one breath, basically. And slow but steady wins the race. That was the lesson that I took. She always won the competition, or at least the time that I remember. If you make sure you actually get the words right, you're going to be able to do it properly. So that's a great memory that I've got.
Do you have any wisdom that you think about when you do your Haggadah? What's your interesting insights and stuff like that?
So when I was an undergraduate student at McGill University, I davened at the ghetto shul, whom many of your listeners might know. It was a student-run synagogue at McGill, and the rabbi of the shul in those days was a man by the name of Leibe Schundert, who was really my rav, my spiritual guide for my 3 years at McGill. And the first ever seder that I had with him back in spring of 2010 really blew my mind. I was introduced to a kind of seder, to a kind of Yiddishkeit that I didn't really benefit from growing up. It was pretty cool to start as late as we did, basically starting, with Kiddush after nightfall, which is not something that that I grew up with, having a Seder that went until 3 or 3:15 in the morning, wrapping it up with, very musical and spiritual Hallel, and my Rav Leibe Schundert, as we got to the climax of the Hallel, as we got to Ana Hashem Hoshia Na, he mentioned that the gematria of the root of Hoshia, of salvation, which is just a two-letter root, just Shin Ayin, the value of those two letters together is twice the value of Hapanim. So basically, you've got two faces, two individuals, who are coming together. And it's by looking into each other's faces, looking into each other's eyes, by coming together as human beings, as a community, that we bring about salvation in this world. I find that to be, a powerful theme on its own. But when juxtaposed with the overall restrictions that are present on the Seder night, it becomes even more powerful, and the restrictions that we feel, and that are evident throughout Pesach, that nonetheless we have this theme of people coming together and being able to change the world, to bring salvation together. Despite those restrictions, we're capable of doing so much because we know that the restrictions are there because Hashem loves us. It's an expression of that love. And we have to keep it all in mind and understand the complexity of this, especially in this era that defies easy explanations. But it's because of these seeming contradictions and complexities, if we embrace all of it and just remember that Hashem loves us, we can gradually get to a better place.
Hi, I'm Naomi Harris. I am a photographer. I moved home from Los Angeles back to Toronto in 2018 to help with my dad after he had a fall, more to help my mom with his care. And then 8 months later, she was diagnosed with cancer. So became a lot of caregiving. And in April 2020 was the last Seder that the three of us spent together because it was COVID. It was only the three of us. I mean, our Seders used to be really big because we had extended family, but the family shrunk over the years as people aged out, if you know what I mean. So my dad had a tradition of reciting the four questions, even though he was not the youngest, I was the youngest, he would recite the four questions because he would recite them in Yiddish as well as how he learned them as a child. And it always was a source of, a good chuckle for all of us. And the last Passover, I had a feeling it was the last one.
Well, I hope this isn't recorded so people will hear how nasty we are.
I'm going to
do the fear cautious.
Read it in Yiddish.
It wasn't the best rendition of the four questions, but I recorded it just so I could now watch it with my memories of my parents.
Mama, ich will der Fragen, der vier Kaschers. Mama, nicht tana, halayla, hazam, ikol, halaylois. Was ist anders, die dozige Nacht von Pesach, von alle Nacht, von der ganzen Jahr.
And then basically, I now am an orphan. I've been, this will be my second Passover. My mom, she died in November 2022. But yeah, I guess what I want to say to anyone listening, if you know someone who is has lost people in their lives and they're essentially an orphan, or maybe not, maybe they just don't have good relationship with their family. Passover and all the holidays, frankly, but Passover is a hard time of year for a lot of us because we have only the memories and no one to actually celebrate Passover with. So I believe it's a mitzvah to extend an invitation and add another seat. I don't mind sitting at a kid's table. I don't have to even be with the adults. And
my 99-year-old neighbor, Anne, who I go walking with every day, her and her son used to come to our Seder. So last year they had me come to theirs, and I'm going to go back again this year. So that'll be nice. It'll be sort of more reminiscent of Seder's past because they were guests at that, those Seders. And another family friend has invited me to her family Seder. My mom made amazing creme sala. So I don't know where she got the recipe, I guess, from my father's mother, my grandmother, because my mom did not grow up Jewish, but she made the most killer creme sala. And for those of you who don't know what that is, they're basically like little mini bubalas that you put in the soup. And so whenever I go to people's homes, I make those because I have the recipe in her handwriting that I like to pull out and make her creme sala. What's interesting is going to different people's theaters, you see how different it's celebrated. But I'll probably bust out the video of Dad suing the four questions when it's time to do those and share it with the my hosts at the Seders I'm going to.
Shepho Halelois Anu Oichlin Chametzu Matzah Alunat Esmer Chametzu Matzah Halayla Hazel Kuloi Matzah Tadazika Nacht from Pesach Esmer Nor Matzah.
It's a bittersweet time of year, right?
So, Phoebe, you read my article that just came out in the CJN magazine. You had some thoughts?
Yes. Well, my first thought is that everybody else should also go read it. And you pick up on some stuff we actually had talked about on the Bonjour Chai podcast.
Who'd have thunk?
So you start off by talking about somebody who was criticizing the Seder for being too Judeo-centric, a non-Jewish commentator on such issues.
Yes.
Felt that Jews should stop making these Jewish holidays all about Jews. You go a lot of interesting places with this question of universal versus particular, whether the Seder is sort of an everyone-directed moment or whether it's about Jews looking inward. Do you want to expand on that a little? Like what would be the elevator pitch for your article?
The elevator pitch is that Judaism really sits in the middle space between the universalism and particularism, and it doesn't try to pick one side or another. It really, I think, the best way to be Jewish is to live in that tension and to always recognize that there are moments when we're in one way and there are moments when we're in another. But there are movements, there are denominations, there are Jews who think highly, highly particularistic or highly, highly universalistic, and that's a problem sometimes. And this all started because I was giving this talk at a Reconstructionist congregation, and there was a moment that happened that I was like, oh, these people are highly universalistic, and anytime you say something about Judaism that is very particular, that raises all the hackles. All the hackles got raised, and they were like, oh, no, you can't say that. You can't do that. And I was like, no, but I think the Seder is a very particularistic night. This is the night that makes us us. I get that there are very universalistic places in Judaism and in life where we want things to be for everybody. But there was a, you know, I say this every time I think about startups and I think about the new culture that we're in, whether it's technology or other things. And, you know, who's your product for? Because you have to be able to answer that. And if you're making something for everybody, you're making something for nobody. And it's not just about a shared history. There's a shared day-to-day life that non-Jews non-involved Jews may not be celebrating. And so the Seder is this night, for me at least, to say, you know, non-Jews might be welcome at the Seder, but at the end of the day, this is our night for our culture, our holiday, our faith, our traditions, however you define yourself as a Jew. This is a night where Jews get to celebrate Judaism. And we don't need to like lump on all sorts of other things on top of it. Let this night be this night. And other holidays have that as well. It's not just one night a year, but even if it's just one night a year or two nights a year, whatever it's going to be. Let that be that. And don't feel the need to like, well, we have to commemorate this experience, we have to commemorate that experience. That's not what the Seder is for, at least not in my opinion.
But what I wanted to ask you about, and this is where you're going to get the angry calls and so forth, angry emails, maybe or maybe not. How do you connect this to this year in particular?
So I really think that this year might be different because, you know, as we spoke about before, there's going to be a lot of heated discussion around what's going on in the world right now because so much of the headlines space is grabbed today by the Israel-Palestine war, what's going on in Gaza, what's going on in Israel, what's going on in Iran and Israel now, and that there are so divergent opinions about this within the Jewish community. Actually, this year might be a year when we can talk about that at the Seder, but not because I'm giving an exception to, you know, like, well, generally we don't talk about these things, but this year you can talk about it because it's so heated. It's that I think that the Seder and the language of the Seder is so filled with arguments on both sides, and to show that the Seder actually is a model for being able to say that we hold divergent opinions, we hold contradictory opinions, that this, that the Haggadah talks about the fact that we were slaves, and therefore as a result of that, we have to be kind to slaves, and that's what the Torah talks about that extensively, and we have to care about others, and that there is this universalistic approach, but there is much in the Haggadah that is what we would call a problematic text about how, you know, we want to pour, ask God to pour wrath upon the other nations.
Are you saying that the Haggadah has things in it that would not be very 2024 friendly? Because this is upsetting to me. I'm joking, Avi.
It's not a joke. There are people who want to cut things out of the Seder because they call them problematic texts and say, we don't want this.
So to bring it back to some more concrete things. So I'm thinking a little bit about, is this the moment to, at the Seder, what should be said about the war at the Seder? Ritualistically, is there something that should be done, do you think? Because I've seen some articles about this, about like that you should do different things with matzah.
If you're curious about looking for what to do differently at the Seder this year or any other year.
But do you think people should do things differently?
I think if it's meaningful to you, then you should. Especially if it's fits in with whatever you're, everybody has their own comfort level for how strict you have to hew to a text. But everybody knows that everybody strays in some way or another. And as soon as you recognize that you have some sort of leeway, you should feel free to use that leeway, and you should feel almost obligated to use that leeway to move forward with thinking about things differently this year or other years, right? You may not want to put an orange on your Seder plate because you're like, that's sacrilege, but everybody does things, you know, a little bit different, a little bit this, a little bit that. What I would say is, if you're actually curious about that, go read 10 different people's opinions for what you should do, whether it's the two matzahs instead of three matzahs, because that doesn't take away from the laws of matzah and it still is acceptable, but it makes something different, or whether it's something else from somebody else. Go read, and there's countless numbers of suggestions for what to do this year at the Seder, and find the one that's actually meaningful to you. You have a responsibility to put in some work and to do something that's unique and different. It's not just, oh, go do this, or I'm waiting for somebody to feed me a line. It's put in a little bit of work for your Seder, and not just read off the page and move on.
Shalom Aleichem. It's Chaime here from Yid Life Crisis, and we just wanted to wish you all a Passover greeting.
Cleaning and cooking in so many dishes. Out with the chametz, no pasta, no knishes. Fish that's gefilted, horseradish that stings. These are a few of our Passover things.
Okay, so on the theme of universalism and particularism, let's hear from Emile Scher, the writer in residence at the Jewish Public Library in Montreal, and the divine Gila Munster.
Fetches an uncle who sings, these are a few of our Passover things.
Mutzi and Maror in trouble with pharaohs.
Bamboos and locusts that slave with wheelbarrows.
Hi there, my name is Emile Scher, and I have the pleasure of being the writer-in-residence at the Jewish Public Library in Montreal, and I write weekly essays, which are really in the form of letters to my daughters, framed by quotes by Abraham Joshua Heschel. And this week's essay actually began with a quote by Susanna Heschel. And what I did specifically was talk about the orange on the Seder plate, which is something we've done for many, many years in my home. I just want to read what we have read up till this year. It is going to change from this point forward. What I say is, we have added an orange to our Seder plate in response to a comment made by a Jewish scholar when asked what he thought about including women on the bima during Jewish religious ceremonies. He replied, "A woman on the bima is as out of place as an orange on a Seder plate. And so we now include an orange on a Seder plate as a symbol of justice and rights for women all over the world." I couldn't have been more wrong. I have since found out, and by the way, this understanding of the origins of the orange on the Seder plate, I think is widely accepted, the one I just shared. lo and behold, I did a bit of digging. Here's what Susanna Heschel herself had to say, daughter of Abraham Joshua Heschel. I discovered some years ago that an urban legend was circulating, and she wrote this in 2013 in the foreword. Strangers told me they placed an orange on their Seder plate because of an incident in Miami Beach, in which a man angrily denounced me when I gave a lecture, saying that a woman belongs on the bima of a synagogue no more than an orange belongs on the Seder plate. That incident never happened. My custom had fallen victim to a folktale process in which my original intention was subverted. And later on she says, a woman's words are attributed to a man, and the affirmation of lesbians and gay men is erased. Isn't that precisely what's happened over the centuries to women's ideas? Which also makes me wonder how many other origin stories have been distorted over time, and to what degree do we have a responsibility to really almost uncover the truth, if you will. And I want to end with, again, Susanna Heschel's words of why we use an orange, or why we place an orange on the Seder plate. When we eat that orange segment, we spit out the seeds to repudiate homophobia, and we recognize that in a whole orange, each segment sticks together. Oranges are sweet and juicy and remind us of the fruitfulness of gay and lesbian Jews and of the homosociality that has been such an important part of Jewish experience, whether of men in yeshivas or of women in the Ezrat Nashim, the women's gallery in a synagogue. So as we move forward, I invite you to add an orange to your Seder plate and explain its true origins. Happy Pesach.
Leroy, what does freedom mean to you?
Reading a book.
Reading a book? What about you, Sarah? What do you like to do?
Play with Barbies.
Play with Barbies? Does that make you feel good to play with Barbies? And Eric, what do you like to do in your free time?
Learn.
Do you learn lots at school and at home?
Yeah.
Amazing. Thanks, everybody.
Hi, it's Gila Munster, Toronto's cross-dressing and cross-stitching drag superstar. Besides being the creator of the annual 8 Gays of Hanukkah show, the thing that people know me best for is Drag Queen Storytime, where I read stories about self-love and pride to children in schools and libraries. Over the last year, it's been a hot-button issue, with people baselessly accusing drag performers of being pedophiles and even grooming children. I gotta tell you, I can barely groom my own wigs. The question I keep getting asked is, if my programming attracts all this negativity, why do I persist? Telling stories is an inherently Jewish tradition. The Passover Haggadah tells us that in each and every generation, person is obligated to tell his sons about how the Jews came out of Egypt, from slavery to freedom. This storytelling tradition maintains the strong bonds of our culture and instills a sense of community in all of us, especially the young ones. Sharing my stories about pride and self-love is an exercise of the same idea. Queer people have been silenced many times over the years, and entire links in our chain were broken by events like the Holocaust, the AIDS crisis, and by violence. I see it as my personal responsibility and obligation as a queer Jew to be a storyteller for my community, to teach the new generation that they are part of a magnificent and long-lasting chain. That is why I keep reading. And if all of that doesn't convince you, the money's pretty good too. Wishing you Chag Pesach Kasher V'Sameach.
Before we continue, why don't we take a moment and hear from our sponsors for today.
Are you in the market for a new watch or a special piece of jewelry? Are you looking for the perfect engagement ring to pop the question? Atelier Lou has all this and more. Eric and the team at Atelier Lou can craft a piece for you, or you can select from some of the exclusive designers that they offer. From a simple bangle to a statement necklace, Atelier Lou can make you or your loved one sparkle. Located in the heart of Westmount in Montreal or online at atelierlou.com, visit Atelier Lou for your next watch or jewelry purchase. And when you do, make sure to use promo code BON18 for 10% off your next purchase. That's atelierlou.com.
God in psalm and song.
Shalom, I'm Dr. Lisa Skatolsky,
editor-in-chief of Cannabis Jew magazine, devoted to recovering the Jewish history of cannabis use and advocacy as a source of Jewish pride. I will offer a Cana-Jewish reading of the Exodus that recovers the role played by Cana-Bassam, what we now call cannabis, through deduction, speculation, and the light of Jewish herstory. Miriam had the courage and ingenuity to place baby Moses in a basket. Our question is, what kind of basket was this? And where did she get it? We know that cannabis was cultivated in ancient Egypt and grew in the Nile Delta Valley and was used in the production of ropes, sails, and fabric. Thus, it's fair to surmise that Miriam placed Moses in a basket woven with hemp, cultivated in her private garden of Cana-Bassam near the river. Moses' return was inspired by his experience on Mount Horeb when he stared at a burning bush and heard the Lord speak to him through the flames. I am that I am. The Hebrew word translated as bush is sene, which refers in particular to brambles or brush, like the stalks of Cana-Bassam. Second, the Sinai Valley is known for exceptionally potent herb with energizing sativa-like effects. When we take these 2 points into account, we can understand why I am not the first Jew to suggest that Moses had actually been stoned when he heard the Lord speak through flames. This canon Jewish perspective affirms our freedom while respecting Cana-Bassam as a gift from Hashem, though usually excluded from our recollection of the Exodus told during the Seder. The story of Miriam's fate after she helped deliver her people feels important to include this year. As soon as they crossed into freedom, Miriam gathered all the Israelite women to celebrate with dancing and drumming. However, the Lord took exception to Miriam's presumption that her sapphic party was kosher and righteous. That went about as well as you'd predict with a headstrong, fearless, proud Jewish woman. Condemned and abandoned by Hashem, Miriam refused to speak to him ever again. As we mourn our Israeli sisters murdered by Hamas and resist the effort to erase their suffering from history, I'm taking strength in Jewish herstory that reveals our sister prophet Miriam as the unsung hero of the Exodus and queen mother of the house of Jewish women.
Hi, I'm Rabbi David Rosen of COR. I'd like to discuss kosher for Pesach laxatives. In our guide, we mention that Metamucil original course is acceptable for Pesach. If you come across a laxative and you would like to know if it's kosher for Pesach, take a picture of the ingredient panel and send it to us, and we will verify if it is kosher for Pesach.
A different song now, this time from the Passover service, the Haggadah, but with a new twist.
Okay, so the Seder traditionally ends with songs about numbers and lists. Let's finish this year's Seder with two very different takes on this. One from accountant Jamie Golombek, and a discussion from two friends, Jonathan Malevsky and Rafi Zions, who ask the question, what would happen if all the Jews left Canada? If you want to read the full article their discussion is based on, you can read it on the CJM website.
My name is Yonatan Malevsky. I teach at Tannenbaum Chat. I teach Tanakh and Jewish history. I'm also a researcher of Jewish thought, and I research anti-Semitism as well.
My name is Rafi Zayons. I've been friends with Yonatan now for about 7 years or so. We met in shul. I think about economics, about Zionism, about anti-Semitism, and Yonatan and I discussed these matters at length.
So the starting point for this article was researching what methods we can use to combat anti-Semitism, and recognizing that we might be at a point where we have to quantify what a mass immigration out of Canada might do for the economy, because other areas of addressing it have not been effective. Holocaust memorials or Holocaust education, certainly social media is making things a lot worse, and that is not being effective. So I started to recognize that that might be making a case for why, if Jews immigrate out of this country, why that would be so detrimental. That might be more effective.
When we put our model together, we wanted it to be simple to understand, but meaningful. And we also didn't want it to enhance anti-Semitism. But I would argue that if we looked at some sort of GDP per capita, some sort of productivity figure for the average Canadian, one could argue the Jews are, you know, that we punch above our weight in terms of productivity. We're blessed to be integrated successfully in all facets of the economy, from academia to medicine and everything in between. But if Jews en masse would start to leave, it would, for instance, exacerbate a healthcare crisis. It could exacerbate a housing crisis. So we do contribute significantly, and we are alleviating crises that exist in Canada. We certainly don't want to add to that. But potentially, if we were to leave en masse, it would most detrimentally add to that. So on average, in Canadian dollars, the average Canadian creates about a little more than $70,000 Canadian in GDP, meaning the value of goods or services that the average Canadian creates towards the economy. You know, if a family doctor invoices $250,000 or $300,000, that doctor alone is four times as valuable, let's say, plus the real estate trickle-down effect, the people they employ, accountants, dentists, architects, teachers, everything that we do has a significantly positive impact on the economy. You know, the corollary of that would be that if we were to stop en masse something measurable, GDP actually could be measurably affected in a negative way.
For me, this is also the holiday where we should be asking those kinds of questions. This Passover and other Passovers as well, because there's a tension there between our excellence, the excellence of the Israelites in Egypt, and their strangeness. Excellent at what they did, and yet they were outsiders, and there was a worry about that. And I think that we find that here as well, that if anything, our excellence might actually just keep us in this country. Right. Despite the fact that we're strange and despite the fact that there is some resentment now towards this government about the protection that they should be offering us.
Well, the tie into Pesach is interesting because, you know, as an aside, I have felt even long before October 7th that I live in Avdut, that I don't live in Chayrut, that the Chag of Geula, we have three sons in their 20s. The eldest left for New York. The youngest is in made Aliyah, went to Israel. And our middle son just announced that he wants to follow his big brother and go to the U.S. And it's not even anti-Semitically driven. This is just, for me, kind of a sad icing on the cake where, Yonatan is an expert in history. This is Jewish history repeating itself from the times of Tanakh to today, where, you know, we've lived all over the world as a people. We've achieved success wherever we've been. And yet we're strange, and yet we don't feel welcome. And for the first time in my life, I don't feel welcome. I carry a baseball bat to shul. Whenever I go to shul, I'm walking down the street on Shabbos with a baseball bat. It's my Shabbos nutcracker. I feel that I'm living in the anti-Semitic Toronto that he grew up in. And that as a people, we may have achieved material success, but we haven't advanced. We haven't been accepted en masse. And that is terrifying and sad for me, just tragically sad.
This brings me back to the Haggadah again. It's the time that we always historically vented. We vented about Islam. We vented about Christianity. And I think there's a lot to vent about, unfortunately, this year again. So I think really the way forward is to find some sort of balance between constantly proving our value, and that's going to be necessary, constantly proving our value and trying to move on with our lives in a meaningful way.
Five are the books of the Torah. Four were the matriarchs of Israel. Three, the patriarchs. Two are the tablets of the covenant.
Passover 2024 is, let's say, an interesting time for accountants. After all, many of us are involved with filing tax returns for ourselves and some of us for clients. And this year, the April 30th general tax filing deadline falls on the eighth day of Pesach. This is a particularly challenging time if you don't work on the last 2 days of Pesach, which are considered Yom Tov, meaning that all tax returns really have to be done by Sunday, April the 28th. Passover is a time that is really a wonderful celebration of numbers, especially at the Seder. If you think about all the numbers from the easy ones like four for four cups of wine or the four questions to the sort of, you know, a little bit more interesting ones like the 10 plagues and ultimately the discussion among the rabbis as was it 10 plagues, was it 50 plagues, was it 200 plagues? I think Rabbi Akiva goes as high as to say that perhaps there were 250 plagues. You get into this interesting numerical debate. Of course, one of the memories that I remember most from growing up at the Seder involved numbers, and specifically that final song that we sing just towards the end of the Seder, the Echad Mi Odea song. Really, literally, who knows one? But I remember at my Seder, the highlight was that my grandfather and father would always sing the Echad Mi Odea in Yiddish. Now, of course, to me and my brother, it was completely incomprehensible, the words that they were saying, but it was always fun to watch them sing this very, very quick song in Yiddish. And I understand that some people still have that tradition today to sing the Echad Mi Odea in English. That is one of the fondest memories that I have growing up at the various seders that I did with my family in Toronto.
Taken out of Egypt.
Taken out of Egypt.
I was bound to a burden.
Bound to a burden.
But the burden, it was raised.
Thank you for listening to Bonjour Chai for Passover 2024. The show is produced and edited by Zach Kaufman. The executive producer for CJN Podcasts is Michael Freeman. Our music is by So-Called. We are a project of the Jewish Living Lab and are distributed by the CJN Podcast Network. You can listen to all our past episodes on our page at thecjn.ca/bonjour, and you can subscribe to the podcast and automatically receive all episodes on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. This year, start a new tradition at your Seder. Find someone at the Seder who isn't listening to Bonjour Chai and tell them about it. We love knowing that you are part of our narrative of freedom. And as always, you can email us with comments at bonjour@thecjn.ca. I'm Avi Feingold, and on behalf of Phoebe, Michael Freeman, Zach Kaufman, and the rest of the team here at Bonjour Chai and the entire CJN, we'd like to wish you a Chag Kasher V'Sameach, a happy and kosher Passover.
But the waters parted, and my soul crossed over. Out of Egypt, out of Pharaoh's dream, word of words, measure of all
measure,
blessed is the name.
Blessed is